Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in giving a very warm welcome to our next speaker, a titan of US monetary policy, and all the way from Washington, D.C., Dr. Stanley Fischer.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure being here, and it was a great pleasure listening to Martin Wolf speak and listening to Spencer Dale last night. This is really a very interesting event, and I'm happy to be part of it. The slide that was up here a moment ago said my title was The Process of Monetary Policy. That's a pretty accurate title, particularly if you said the process of U.S. monetary policy. But the actual title is up there on the slide, and the title is I'd rather have Bob Solow than an econometric model, but, and I'll come to the but later. And this is something that I heard from Paul Samuelson when I interviewed him for MIT's oral history project. Now let me turn to the lecture, and I want to start with a moment in my past, in my long-distant past, by describing a eureka moment. Well, eureka moments are rare in all fields, not least in economics. One such moment came to me when I was an undergraduate at the LSE in the 1960s. I was talking to a friend who was telling me about econometric models. He explained that it would soon be possible to build a mathematical model that would accurately predict the future course of the economy. What was obviously but a step from there to realize that the problems of policy making would soon be over. All it would take was a bit of algebra to solve for the policies that would produce the desired values of the target variables. Well, it was a wonderful prospect, and it remains a wonderful idea. But it has not yet happened. I want to talk about why not and about some of the consequences for policy making, and I'll do that by talking about how we make policy at the Fed. The Fed has both centralized and regional characteristics, and there is a very simplified model of a copy of a map that is a huge map that is on the wall at one end of the conference room in which we make our monetary policy decisions. And what you see there is a map of where the regional Federal Reserve banks are located. And what you also see there is a map of the United States economy and population density in 1913. There is nothing between the Midwest and San Francisco. And there's only one Federal Reserve Bank on the West Coast, which was appropriate in 1913, and there was a huge battle between San Francisco and Los Angeles to get that Federal Reserve, and San Francisco won. Every now and then there are proposals to reorganize these Federal Reserve banks. It isn't going to happen, they are where they are, and it matters less, but it still matters, than it would have 150 years ago. So this is the system. It has both centralized and regional characteristics. There is the Board of Governors, which is in Washington, D.C., and 12 regional reserve banks across the United States. The president appoints or nominates the members of the Board of Governors, and they are subject to confirmation by the United States Senate. In contrast, the president of each of the 12 reserve banks is selected by that reserve bank's Board of Directors, and it is subject to the approval of the Board of Governors. This scheme was designed both to insulate the Federal Reserve from day-to-day political pressures and to ensure that all parts of the country have a voice in the central bank. It was a fascinating process, as you may know. two central banks of the United States were closed in the 19th century. Basically, there was a suspicion of central banking by the rest of the country, which feared that making the central bank, creating a central bank, enshrined New York as the key point of the United States financial and economic system, and they hated New York, and some of them still do. Our Monetary Policy Committee, the Federal Open Market Committee, meets 8 times a year at the Federal Reserve Board in Washington to make decisions about the interest rate and other aspects of monetary policy. Sitting around the massive conference table, I'm told it weighs 2 tons, and that the chandelier that I occasionally look up at with a little concern weighs 1,200 pounds, and I'm never quite sure whether it's a good thing to be at the center of the table, which is where the chair of the Fed and I and others sit. The board has a maximum, the board, that is the Federal Reserve Board, which is in Washington, D.C., has a maximum of 7 members, but at present 2 slots are empty. All of the Federal Reserve Bank presidents take part in the discussion, which means that there, in principle, are 19 people who can talk at the FOMC meeting. Because all the Federal Reserve Bank presidents take part in the discussion, although only 5 of them have the vote at any one time, New York plus 4 of the others on a rotating basis. Each board member or Reserve Bank president has his or her own way of preparing for those meetings. In the case of the Reserve Bank presidents, these preparations can include consultations with their boards of directors, with business contacts in their districts, with market experts, and other sources. Those discussions are an important part of the proceedings as we discuss what to do about the interest rate, because each president who speaks, each of the 12 who speak, will start with a presentation on what's happening in his or her district. So you start with a report on what is happening in the entire economy. Written materials are distributed to all participants in the FOMC in advance of the meeting, and most of those written materials come from the board itself. And the most extensive of those materials is called the Teal Book. Teal, I understand, is the color which combines green and blue, and it's consistent with the history of this Teal Book. It's a 2-part document prepared by the board staff and distributed to all the participants, and I'll talk a bit about the Teal Book. The first part of the Teal Book contains a summary and analysis of recent economic and financial developments in the United States and abroad. The board staff's economic forecast, and dozens of tables and figures. The board staff's baseline forecast of the most likely path for the economy over the next several years is judgmental, built by staff economists using their expertise on particular sectors, together with econometric models and other inputs. But they don't hesitate if they have reason to change some part of the model forecast to substitute for it. In addition to this baseline judgmental forecast, the staff provides model-based simulations of a number of alternative scenarios or risks. For instance, what would happen if the price of oil were to be lower, the US dollar stronger, or wage growth higher than envisaged in the baseline? And these are generated fundamentally using one or more of the board's macroeconomic models. And then the Teal Book also contains computations of policy paths derived from a range of policy rules and model-based estimates of optimal policy. So that is to say, before we meet, we all have an opportunity to examine analyses and forecasts produced by our staff, as well as empirical results from a range of models, and of course, material that each participant has gathered from his or her own research and experience. The second part of the Teal Book includes the specific policy options that we consider at the meeting. Typically, there are three policy alternatives, labeled imaginatively A, B, and C, ranging from dovish to hawkish, with the centrist one in the middle. And if anyone ever asks you to choose between A, B, and C, and you know nothing about them, you choose B. So typically, but not always, B is what is decided. This part, the second part of the Teal Book, includes an analysis of each of the three possibilities and a draft of this public statement that the FOMC would release after the conclusion of its meeting, and anybody is free to propose changes in the wording of the policy decision that we eventually arrive at. Now, four times a year, before the March, June, September, and December meetings, board members and Reserve Bank presidents submit their own projections for real GDP, for the unemployment rate, for inflation, and, what is the key point, the committee's policy rate target, the federal funds rate. These forecasts are released to the public shortly after the FOMC meeting in the Summary of Economic Projections, which is called the SEP, and they receive a great deal of scrutiny by financial market participants and journalists. Now, if you follow this, I want to just emphasize one point. The projections in the SEP of policy are based not on what each person thinks the committee is going to decide, but on what they think appropriate policy is. You are not getting a collective forecast out of the SEP. You are getting 12 different views, although we typically publish the medians of currently 17 different views, at full strength, 19 different views. So each person has written down what they think is the appropriate policy path. The public often misinterprets those interest rate paths as a projection of the committee's policy path or a commitment to a particular path or a forecast. It is not. We publish the median of the interest rate projections. It probably is close to what would be a forecast. It was initially put in because it was hoped we could generate a forecast of the committee, but we can't, because there are different views in the committee as to what should be done and what a collective forecast of people who have fundamentally different views should be is not obvious, and we haven't arrived at one. Now let me talk about the models we use and how monetary policy is modeled. And I want to talk about models, which is where the Solow quote comes from. So the board staff maintains several models. The best known is something called Furbus. Furbus is a way of pronouncing a five-letter acronym, FRBUS, Federal Reserve Board US model. And Furbus is the best known and most used of the models we have. People like me tend to remember it by its original name, which was MPS, where the M was MIT, P was Penn, and S was the financier, the Social Science Research Council. Furbus is an, I'm going to say four things. They're each italicized. It's an estimated model, a large-scale model, a general equilibrium model, and a new Keynesian model. And each of these adjectives matters, and I'll explain why. First, for models to be useful, they need to be estimated such that they do a reasonable job of fitting the data. Only under these circumstances can you consider their predictions as useful. Of course, as you all know, no model fits the data perfectly. The economy is an extremely complicated mechanism, and every macroeconomic model is a vast simplification of reality. Second, the large scale of Phoebus is an advantage in that it can perform a wide variety of computational what-if experiments. I'm frequently struck as we sit there and something happened yesterday in the economy, and somebody says, well, what is the impact of whatever happened yesterday? And the staff has an answer. You can do almost everything if you understand that model well enough, because you can ask, where would that decision affect the economy? Where in the model would that be reflected? And what is the result? So that is enormously useful in guiding our thinking. Third, the general equilibrium structure of the model is important. It's helpful to be able to understand, for example, what has to accompany a hypothetical appreciation of the dollar. Could it have been caused by an increase in share prices? Or is there something else going on? And finally, the new Keynesian nature of the model implies that wages and prices are sticky, and then markets adjust slowly to their longer-run equilibria. So that's the nature of this model. It's not a mystery. It's on the Fed website. There's a program for allowing you to simulate results and to solve it. So go to the... but it's not simple. There is a simplified version, but what we work with is quite complex. Now, much of its usefulness comes from its careful modeling of the monetary transmission mechanism and the key role that the expectations of households, workers, firms, and investors play in that mechanism. I want to say something about the monetary policy transmission mechanism, which obviously is the way through which a change in central bank policy affects the economy. In Phoebus, the usual policy instrument, the federal funds rate, plays no direct role in the economy. Rather, an increase in the federal funds rate affects expectations of future values of the federal funds rate, and it is the present value or the entire structure of future federal funds rate that determines prices of long-term bonds, that influence equity prices, and that influence the exchange value of the US dollar. So there's an indirect effect of monetary policy, and households and firms are forward-looking in that adjustment costs, which I mentioned, require them to respond, and they will respond gradually, in consumption, in their savings, and in what they expect about future employment and wages. And all of these decisions, in turn, shape employment, output, and inflation. So the expectations of decision makers, be they households, firms, or investors, are at the center of how monetary policy works in the real world and in Phoebus. At the same time, the economy is subject to economic shocks. There are approximately as many external shocks as there are shocks in the behavioral equations in the structure of Phoebus. And they perturb the plans of economic agents as well as the plans and expectations of policymakers. So the policymakers have to respond to economic shocks as well as they can, and thereby influence economic outcomes and expectations in order to achieve the central bank's assigned goals. Our goals are very unusual among central banks. We have a dual mandate. There is a target inflation rate, which is set at 2%, and maximum sustainable employment. So we have to take both those goals into account, and we do not have a primacy for the inflation rate. I used to think when I was the governor of the Bank of Israel that that enormously complicated policy, but at least in the period I've been in the Fed, inflation and employment have been moving together. That is, it's been largely determined by demand effects, and those have the same impacts in the same directions. Now, this emphasis on expected variables is almost certainly correct, and the conduct of monetary policy is often described as a matter of expectations management. And if you want to follow that up, well, if you want to follow anything up in this lecture, there are lots of footnotes. So how are you supposed to respond to economic disturbances and to influence expectations? Well, the Teal Book for each meeting provides monetary policy prescriptions from a variety of simple policy rules, including John Taylor's famous rule, which has actually been expanded into a family of rules with different parameters in each rule. And since economic conditions and the outlook change from meeting to meeting, not surprisingly, the prescriptions of policy rules change with them. Now, I'm going to talk in the remainder of the lecture about two Teal books, the Teal Book from April 2011 and the Teal Book from August 2011. Is that because I like prime numbers and 11 is a prime number? No. It's because there's a five-year lag in publishing the transcripts of our meetings. So after 5 years, you know exactly what was said at the meeting, and I want to draw on what was said at the meetings. I wasn't there to enable you to see the sort of things that people on the FOMC look at. So first, April 2011. At that time, the federal funds rate had been near zero for almost 2.5 years, and the FOMC had been indicating in its post-meeting statements that it expected to keep the federal funds rate target at exceptionally low levels, and now I quote, for an extended period. No one was quite sure what an extended period was, but it was long. That was about as much as you knew. Well, what you see in figure two are panels from the April 2011 Teal Book that show what the staff's baseline forecast was. The baseline forecast is, I don't know if I've got a, I guess I don't have a laser on this. The baseline forecast is the black one, which you see at the left, and that's what the staff thought would happen to the interest rate in April 2011. They also looked at three other interest rate rules. I mean, the April baseline is based on judgment. The three others are based on different versions of the Taylor rule. Taylor 1993 is the original Taylor rule. Taylor 1999 has more persistence in the interest rate than the original Taylor rule, but it was also used by Taylor in 1999. And then there's a first difference rule, which simply specifies the adjustment in the interest rate that should be made. And those are the three rules. Now, if you look at them, you can see that the most aggressive, the most hawkish of the programs, or at least of the policy it's not a recommendation, it's just a reference point, is the first difference rule. It looks around and it starts raising the interest rate very quickly, and it keeps on raising it, and the interest rate would have been higher with that projection than on any of the other three rules. And correspondingly, if you look to the right, the unemployment rate would have been higher and the inflation rate would have been lower according to that rule, the first difference rule. And the reason is that there's a I mean, I don't know how far you've gotten in macro, but let's assume you've seen the Taylor rule. There's a sort of element, the first element to it is, in the original Taylor rule, it's the equilibrium real interest rate. And then there's a whole lot of stuff which relates to the adjustment of the interest rate. Well, the first difference rule doesn't include the long-run interest rate. It just starts where you are and says, looks at the right-hand side of that and says, let's get on with moving in the direction of what's there. And that was a reflection of the fact, people who criticized the Fed continually said, this interest rate is much too low for this state of the economy. You kept hearing that. And that's what the green line shows. Now, was it too low? Well, the economy was not exactly in a normal condition at the time. It may well not have been optimal to have the interest rate moving as it moves on the green line, there. So that shows you how they present facts to the board, how the staff presents facts to the board, and shows how these different rules would have affected the economy. So given those things, how does the FOMC choose its interest rate decision? Well, fundamentally, it uses these charts, which are an important but far from the only input into the discussion. And when the board starts talking about what they're going to do, members of the policy committee have to explain why they want to do what they want to do, why they want to raise the interest rate or why they don't, or why they might even want to reduce it. And there's a process of persuasion that takes place, even though everybody can see all that. Now I want to move on to discuss one of the hardest and most interesting decisions that the FOMC made in 2011, and that was the decision in August 2011. At that time, the target for the federal funds rate had been set at near zero for more than 2.5 years. And although the economy had improved from the depths of the Great Recession, the unemployment rate was still above 9%, the highest post-war unemployment rate in the United States was 10%, so it was very high by post-war standards. And then over the summer, the economic outlook darkened considerably. Remember, what's up there is that on the baseline forecast, the interest rate would have been raised somewhere in the first quarter of 2012. But the outlook had darkened, and the staff concluded that if they followed that path, the economy would stay with higher unemployment for too long and for much longer than is shown on the April 2011 charts. So we move on to, We won't go into the whole set of diagrams that were in the Teal book, but this is a fundamental diagram that was there. And what you see are optimal policy paths under various assumptions. The one assumption was the one with the blue line, is what interest rate you would have had if it had been possible to get a negative interest rate. So it says that if you could have gotten a negative interest rate, you'd have taken it to about 2.5%. Minus 2.5%, and it would have stayed there till well into 2014. That was what they said. Then There are two others. There is a optimal one, which is the one in the one that's called Tealbook constrained, and that's the black one, and that's constrained to stay above zero. And then there's what the Tealbook. Well, there's one constrained, and there should be one that's unconstrained. Sorry. Well, June 2011 is what they said at the previous meeting where they presented these forecasts, where there was a Tealbook. And you see that in the red one, in June, they expected to raise the interest rate from zero, starting somewhere before 2014. So what was to happen? The staff had reached the conclusion that the interest rate was, the interest rate expectation was too aggressive, and that they should move the interest rate change out further. Now, you're dealing with expectations. You're not dealing with a policy. I mean, you're not dealing with a number that the Fed could fix, because the number the Fed could fix was the one that, at that point, that the blue one starts turning down. So they're talking about what they're going to do something like 3 years out. And that sounds pretty complicated. Well, it is pretty complicated. Now, at that meeting, and you read this reading the transcript, most members agreed that the economic outlook had deteriorated, and it had deteriorated by enough to make it to warrant a response. Some of them judged that the additional stimulus was called for because they thought the economy wouldn't get back to full employment at all without it. That's kind of an extreme view. But they argued that a strengthening of the language in the committee's post-meeting statement about how long they expected the federal funds rate to remain exceptionally low would be appropriate. And they judged that this response would influence expectations and thus longer-term interest rates, and would help the public understand what the committee would eventually do. The change that was eventually proposed and adopted replaced the phrase that characterized how long the committee expected the federal funds rate to remain low, remember quotes, for an extended period, with something different. It put in a date, at least through mid-2013. Now, they're making a decision in 2011, and they're trying to influence expectations. And expectations matter for long-term interest rates. So, as shown now in figure four, that announcement that it would go through mid-2013 rather than for an extended period reduced interest rates immediately. This is the difference between the interest rates on August the 8th and those on August the 9th, after the decision was announced and after the statement was put out. So you have a 20 basis point reduction in longer term interest rates. The 7-year rate is the one most affected. The 7-year rate is the most traded of 7 and 10 years are the most traded of the longer term bonds. And that's where you saw it showing up, and obviously for the short term, the rate didn't change very much. Now, you may say 20 basis points is nothing, but you have to ask yourself about percentages of percentages. 20 basis points on an interest rate of 1% is quite a lot. It's 20%. So those are large declines in interest rates relative to what there was at the time the decision was made. Now, I've discussed this with people who were there, and they said, well, we made that forecast, and it turns out that if you go back to figure three, that those forecasts of the interest rate and the accompanying forecasts of the unemployment rate and the inflation rate were reasonably accurate. But they said we had to do a lot of things, small changes in interest rates, to make that happen. But they did make it happen. And so what you've got here is an example of forward guidance, something they decided long in advance, which worked out, but it didn't work out because they knew exactly what was going to happen for the next 3 years. It worked out because they helped make that happen by intervening in the markets and so forth. And that's, we stopped holding the interest rate at zero at the end of 2014. And those of you who were undergraduates, starting your undergraduate career in 2014, will remember there was something called a taper tantrum. And the taper tantrum happened when Ben Bernanke announced something which we thought everybody knew, that the Fed was going to end the zero interest rate. But when he announced it, the world went nuts, and you had to try and figure out why the world went nuts and what you could do about it, as they did go nuts. But as the staff reminds me, the path of the economy was very close to what they had expected in 2011. Now, how on earth do you get such a decision? Well, you certainly don't get it out of what you see in the charts for 2000, in figure two and figure three. What it really took was leadership by the chairman, who was Ben Bernanke at the time, long deliberations of the board and of the reserve, of board members and Reserve Bank presidents, and a lot of briefings from the staff and the forecast. This decision was a joint product. It reflected the experience of policymakers, it reflected their insights, it reflected implicit or explicit models of views of the world they had brought with them to the FOMC table, an understanding of historical episodes, and other information gleaned from the outside world. So what should we take from this episode? Well, I'll tell you what I take. The interest rate decision taken in August 2011 was unusual in that a decision was made not about the next interest rate, that was not going to change, but about the likely path of future interest rates. That's relatively unusual to be that specific about future interest rates. Most meetings decide what the interest rate is going to be set at the end of the current meeting. But either way, in reaching its decision, the committee will examine the prescriptions of different monetary rules and the implications of different model simulations. But it should never decide what to do until it has carefully discussed the economic logic that underlies its decision. Nobody who is responsible for making a decision will walk into the meeting, be handed a set of printouts of a computer program and say, that's it, that's what we're going to do. If they are going to do that, they're going to discuss it at some length. And they're going to try and make sure that it's the right thing and what to do. So a monetary rule or a model simulation or both will likely be part of the economic case supporting a monetary policy decision. But they cannot typically be the full justification for the decision. And sometimes a Monetary Policy Committee will make a decision that is not consistent with the prescriptions of standard monetary rules, and doing that may well be the right thing to do. Further, in modern times, the policy statement of the Monetary Policy Committee will seek to explain why the committee is making the decision it is announcing. The quality of those explanations, the quality of what the committee says to the public, is a critical part of the policy process. For good decisions and good explanations of those decisions help build the credibility of the central bank, and a credible central bank is a more effective central bank. So let me come to the bottom line. First of all, As the August 2011 meeting illustrates, the eureka moment I thought I had when I was an undergraduate was, and here I use a word which I had to listen to on Google, a chimera. What is that? Well, I think it's, you could substitute the word mirage, I think, roughly, for it. But I'd never heard anybody say this word until I said it myself, until I heard the Google voice saying it. I used to always think the word was chimera. Well, it isn't. It's chimera. So why did I wrong? Well, first, the economy is very complex, and whatever model you build will let you down on occasion, and you've got to be aware of that. And a particular difficulty is that expectations of the future play a critical role in determining how the economy reacts to a policy change. Moreover, the economy changes over the course of time, which means that policymakers need to be able to adapt their models promptly and accurately in real time. And finally, no one model or policy rule can capture the varied experiences and views brought to policymaking by a committee. You have to ask yourself, why does almost every central bank have a committee make the decision? Why don't you just run the models and get on with it? So those are the reasons that you can't rely entirely on models. These factors recommend against accepting the prescriptions of any one model or policy rule at face value. And now to the bottom line. The title of the speech, I've forgotten what it was. I'd rather have Bob Solow than an econometric model. But so, what is the but? Well, what Paul Samuelson said was this: I'd rather have Bob Solow than an econometric model, but I'd rather have Bob Solow with an econometric model than without one. And Samuelson, who was a shameless eclectic, would almost certainly have said essentially the same thing about policy rules. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your insight, Dr. Stanley. We would now like to open the floor to any questions. Up there, top left.
Hi, I wanted to ask about the Dodd-Frank rule and what your views were on whether it should be repealed or not, and if it was repealed, is the financial infrastructure strong enough to protect from another financial crisis?
Well, I don't think the Dodd-Frank Act as a whole is going to be repealed. There may be some adjustments in it, some of which have been already spoken about by the administration, including being less demanding of community banks, which are a relatively small proportion of the banking system, but very important to the communities in which they operate, which are typically much smaller communities, and they're typically just one bank in a town. So that is something that I think will change. It has already changed. The Fed, changed the scale at which the full apparatus of tests, stress tests, et cetera, and particular reserve, very high reserve requirements is implemented. There are many aspects of that are extremely important. Significantly reducing capital requirements would reduce the safety of the system, and we certainly hope it's not going to happen, and particularly for the big banks, and so forth. So I think it's not a matter of will it be repealed. There will be adjustments in some parts of Dodd-Frank. There have been since it was put into place, and they might well continue.
Take a question from the far right over there. I think we only have one microphone. The gentleman at the top right up there.
Thank you very much for your talk. Do you think we will see a change to a non-cash economy, potentially in the US, and would you advocate it?
Well, I sort of grew up using cash, and you probably need to ask a 20-year-old Swede whether they foresee that. I think the US population is a little more conservative than Sweden, than the Swedish population, and I don't think it's going to happen, and it's something that is, one understands the benefits of doing that, but one also understands the difficulties of doing that. So I don't expect, you know, nobody knows where we'll be 100 years from now, we can't even bet on this. Although, as Martin Wolf spoke earlier, I was wondering whether your family is obligated to settle your debts if you pass away in the meantime, your gambling debts. So I don't know, but I'm not going to bet with you.
The gentleman up front here.
In his campaign and also recently, Donald Trump has announced a change in fiscal and trade policy. But he has been rather vague. How do you deal with the uncertainty surrounding Donald Trump's policies, and especially with regards to how you model the expectations in the economy?
Well, at the moment, basically, there is, as you imply, significant uncertainty about what's actually going to happen. I don't think anybody quite knows what's going to come out of the process, which involves both the administration and the Congress deciding on fiscal policy and a variety of other things. So at the moment, we're going strictly according to what we see as our responsibility according to the law, which is to maintain full employment. We're very nearly there. There could be a further somewhat strengthening of the labor market, and to get inflation to 2%. That's how we'll work on the basis of whatever expectations we have, but we don't want to put in very clear expectations when I don't think they exist in the policy making apparatus yet.
We have a question down here at the front.
Just to follow up on that point, you don't see then the prospect of a repeat of the Volcker-Reagan episode, where there was expansionary fiscal, tight money, and the dollar going up. That's not what you foresee.
We have a very clear objective function, which has two variables in it, inflation and employment, and we're going to act on that basis. As a result of certain policies, inflation rises and we're at full employment and there's no spare capacity in the economy, we'll react as anybody who knew economics would, and we'll go on that basis, not trying to prevent the outcome of whatever policy measures the administration wants. We've got a job and we're going to focus on that.
The lady in the front here on the right.
Good afternoon, Dr. Fischer. I would like to take you across the Atlantic over here to Europe. Although we're in the land of sterling, I wanted to ask you, what you believe, given your experience, the ECB should do about the Eurozone and the uncertainty here in Europe?
We have sort of rules of behavior among the fraternity and sorority of central bankers. They include not telling the other guy what to do when he knows much more about it than you do, than I do. Maybe not than you do. Sorry.
We've got time for one last one. Sitting on the stairs, just there, at the front.
Hello. Thank you for your talk. What is your opinion on the sudden impact of demonetization of the Indian currency? Because obviously, it's a very shocking immediate step when it comes to monetary policy.
Well, I've already answered that question. I'm not going to comment on Indian economic policy, and particularly not when it involves a central bank, but not at all. And obviously, it had some unexpected consequences, but. I hope that the problems that caused can be repaired, and I suspect they're figuring out how to do that now.
At that point, we'll end our questions, I'm afraid, but I'm sure you'll all join me in giving Dr. Stanley Fischer a great round of applause for his speech.